that defines the sport of lacrosse. The two winningest programs in the sport of lacrosse, and two teams that have combined for 20 NCAA championships and have produced countless legends. For the first time since 2016, Johns Hopkins and Syracuse is a top 10 matchup. And that feels so right. Anish Roth, Paul Carcaterra with you. This is what it used to be. Top five matchups, top 10 matchups. Crown Lacrosse Classic. We're in Charlotte, North Carolina. Queen City, kings of the sport.
Yeah, everyone says Hopkins and Syracuse are back. Hopkins is back. They went down to Virginia, went to Charlottesville and Kloeckner, and beat the Cavaliers on their home turf. They're hitting on all cylinders right now, Anish. Syracuse, two top five losses in overtime, away from being the number one team in the nation, but they don't have that signature win. They need to beat Hopkins to tell the lacrosse world, not just their fan base, we're back.
Yeah, this game was this close to being a one versus two matchup. Johns Hopkins, though, last week, going to Virginia, winning at Kloeckner, that was a statement that this is a championship team.
It is, and they did it on the back of Matt Collison, the sophomore from Ontario, Canada. 6'4", 225 pounds of force and skill. He had four goals last week. He was the best player on the field. What I love about his game so much, Anish, he does not need to separate from defenders to get his shot off. He will shoot through you.
Collison building off one of the great freshman seasons by a Johns Hopkins midfielder. Four goals in the win against Virginia. Meanwhile, for Syracuse, again, losses to Maryland, losses to Army. Joey Spallina struggled in those games. He's been dynamite against everyone else.
He's the nation's leading scorer, also the top assist man in the country. When he's behind the cage and he's conducting the offense, they're at their best. The issue with Spallina is he gets every opponent's best defender. And tonight, he goes against Scott Smith, a proven right-handed, big-time physical defender who's going to require Spallina's best.
American Legion Stadium in Charlotte, North Carolina. The backdrop for Syracuse and Johns Hopkins. 62nd meeting all time. Hopkins with a slight edge in the overall series. One that dates back to 1921. Mason Cone wins the opening faceoff, and Syracuse goes to work on offense with Spallina. This is Jake Stevens, one of two impact transfers from Princeton, along with Sam English, who you'll see as well. And Stevens will invert against the short stick. Stevens feeding in front. It gets away, and the Hopkins short stick D midfield, giving this team a chance in transition. Hunter Jaronski slips. It's been raining quite a bit over the last 24 hours. Started last night. It's dissipated over the last few hours. But you also had three games, and six teams play on this field before Syracuse and Hopkins got on.
Indeed, and watching those prior contests, there were players losing their footing.
In goal for Hopkins, it is Chase Erlin, a four-year starter at Cornell, reunited with his old Big Red head coach, Peter Milliman.
Yeah, Peter Milliman was around for the early days of Chase Erlin. 2019, as a true freshman for Milliman, he was the starter up in Ithaca.
Finn Thompson defended by Jaronski. Feet in front, behind the back, shot and a score. It's Christian Mulet, the grad transfer from Lehigh. We're past 7 o'clock. Open up a can of, or a copper cup maybe. Moscow Mulet.
Yeah. The lights are flashing. And Christian Mulet now, if you watch the tape, he's been super creative in his fifth year, the grad transfer from Lehigh. You could play him outside as a feeder, but inside, he's so smart with the lacrosse IQ. In the wraparound, losing his angle there, lefty, he knows if he goes BTP with Finn Thompson, the eyes up in the spot feed, that is the exact time you want to go behind your back if you're Christian Mulet. And if you watch prior tapes, he did a similar shot against Army a couple weeks back.
And he gives this offense really a second quarterback to take some pressure off of Joey Spallina.
He's a chameleon. He's one of the top assist players in the country last year when Kevin Cassis was the head coach at Lehigh. He operated behind the cage a ton. Now he's that secondary thought.
Owen Hiltz with the left hand, big save by Erlin. Off the rebound, it's the freshman, Kilrain. He had it, lost it. And we're going to get a loose ball push against Hopkins. It'll stay with Syracuse.
You know, we talk so much about Spallina against Scott Smith. The big chess match today is the midfield of Syracuse, a very deep unit. They could run six or seven guys against the Hopkins short stick defensive midfielders, maybe the deepest group in the country.
They can run six or seven guys.
Yes.
This is Luke Roa. He had four goals in that Maryland game. Working on Patrick Deans, Hopkins top LSM. Stevens now has a short stick matchup. Jackson Raposo trying to stay with him. Stevens slips, angling toward the cage. Doubled.
It's a great
tripled,
double.
And
what
a takeaway, and it's Scott Smith off the ground.
That is a perfectly timed double.
It's going to go back to Syracuse. How about the play along the end line? I think it was Stevens who dislodged the ball, and that's a cause turnover. And this is now becoming an extended possession for the Orange.
And that's what Jake Stevens does so well. He can play anywhere on the field. They say he's the college version of Zach Currier, who plays for the Water Dogs in the PLL. Put him anywhere on a lacrosse field.
Mule feeding inside. Stevens had a great look but missed the cage. One of the factors in this game, you look at Johns Hopkins, maybe as deep as any team in the country. One area where Syracuse may have a slight edge, possessions potentially with faceoffs.
Yeah, and they run two guys with Mason Cone and Johnny Mullins, the spectacular freshman.
Spallina now the nation's leading scorer. Outside hammer by Roa, and Spallina's got the backup. Still plenty of time to shoot.
You watch Aiton White, so two-handed, Anish, Luke Roa. When you watch him play the game of lacrosse in a half-field offense, you have no clue what hand he is.
Feed in front, Mule on the doorstep denied. It comes back to Hiltz. There's that through pass he's made so popular. Spallina picked up by Deans. He'll give it up. The Syracuse team that's 5-2. The only losses in overtime, one to Maryland, one to Army. Johns Hopkins, lone loss in the opener to Denver. Bounce shot by Roa, flagged down as he hits the deck. And Syracuse will go with the extra man.
Jamison Kesterer, the defensive coordinator for Hopkins, is super aggressive. I equate it to a defensive coordinator in football that will throw blitz after blitz on you. He slides so early.
Sometimes you get in trouble because this Hopkins defense has been man down now. It'll be the 27th time.
They're pretty good in this specialty unit, though, holding teams to 38%. As a defensive unit, you want to hold teams under 40%. But this is the aggressive style of Kesterer's defensive philosophy. They are going to slide, especially when you have a short stick. They are sliding. The second you get into, you know, 10 to 12 yards, they're going.
Last year, Syracuse had a dangerous EMO, and so much of it started with 77 Hiltz making that skip pass. Stevens too high, the backup to Syracuse, and the sophomore Michael Leo.
Yeah, they had the most man-up goals in the country a season ago, but they have not been clicking on all cylinders with all these stud players.
Under 40%, Spallina whistles it wide. Early on, Syracuse has had some good looks, but they're missing the cage. Here is Hill to a 14 man-up assists a season ago. Thompson defended by the freshman, Kilrain. They play it to the wing. Erland got a piece of it. And it feels like Hopkins has been on defense for most of these first 5 minutes.
Erland so battle-tested.
Hiltz. He missed the cage.
I thought Erland last week against Virginia was spectacular. He's a calming presence, the sixth-year senior, 22 in black. Big reason why they're such a great clearing team, too, at 92%.
Yeah, Virginia's vaunted ride gave this team little problems last week. Looking for Leo, and that's a turnover.
Yeah, that's a good point, Anish, because Virginia likes to employ that full court press version of the ride in lacrosse. Syracuse a little softer here.
Almost 5 minutes into the game, Syracuse has eight shots, but only two on goal. Hopkins still does not have a shot, period. And now they'll finally get their offense going. And you would imagine you want to give your defense a little breather and you take your time.
Well, when you do that, you give the ball to 23 in black behind Jacob Angeles, one of the primetime feeders, quarterback-type player that makes everything run for this offense that John Crawley, second-year coordinator, has been off the charts with in terms of their movement.
Angeles' pass picked off by Will Mark. Mark's been 50% or better in the five Syracuse wins. He's been in the 40s in the two losses. No goalie in college lacrosse playing right now has more career saves. English, the Princeton transfer, accelerates up ahead. And the trail check from Hopkins to jar it loose. That was Brendan Avilas, the former Syracuse Orange.
Yeah, that's where you see the middle of the field leadership and experience of Johns Hopkins. You know, you mentioned when you have five or six or seven options with the short stick defensive midfield position, every time you put a guy out there, it's full gas.
Avilas last week made a couple of great plays one-on-one against Connor Schellenberger.
He knows when he's on the field, he's going to get his pops, he's going to get his rest, because they're so deep at that spot, but you just get incredible velocity in terms of the way that they run their shorties.
Here is Grimes. What makes this Hopkins offense so tough to defend? Precise ball movement, almost positionless with their top six, interchangeable parts. Angeles, though, is the head of the snake. He's their leading scorer, using the pick from Grimes. Up top to Degnan. It's back to Grimes, trying to get to that left hand. Shot and a score, and Johns Hopkins with its first tally. That's the freshman, Jimmy Ayers. They think he's got a chance to be a special one at Homewood and in Charm City.
He was a player I mentioned to Coach Peter Milliman in our call this week, because when Ayers stepped on Homewood, there was a bunch of alum who were speaking highly of this guy. I turned on the tape, and you know why. He is a spark plug, an incredible dodger, but showing you some creativity inside. His first step and his ability to go at defenders is the first thing you think of with four and black. But now he's learning to play off the ball in this seamless, positionless offense of John Crawley's. Everyone plays everywhere, Anish.
And Peter Millman was telling us that we're not worried about chemistry and mixing and matching because the system has worked. Their only loss was a game against Denver, where Hopkins has had a three-goal lead with 3.5 to go. Denver tied the game at the end of regulation with less than 2 seconds before winning in overtime. If Hopkins held on that day, we're talking about a team right now that is a unanimous number
one. Yes, without question. And, you know, you talk offensively about all those pieces. The one constant, though, I think when the offense is ever in trouble, you just give the ball to Angeles. Yep. He's your calming force. His head is always up. He's always making the right decision.
Here is Mule. He's got the lone Syracuse goal.
Watch how quick they go to support this matchup.
Short stick matchup here. There's the slide. Hiltz skips it across off the stick of English.
If that skip pass works off of a quick slide, it is a step down with time and room.
Mule posting up. Wanted Leo. Another turnover for Syracuse. That's six turnovers already for the Orange, and give this Blue Jay defense credit. They caused three of them.
Yeah, they're sliding with a ton of force. And against a Syracuse team that loves to pass, and if you turn on the tape, all these players are skilled and really fine skip passers, too. They can make that through pass. They have to capitalize. They have to play clean if they want to be able to hang with this team that is maybe the hottest in the country.
Unforced error by the Blue Jays. They wanted Dylan Bauer, the senior from Park City, Utah.
The other piece to all this, too, Anish, is you don't want to negate the face-off advantage you have if you're Syracuse, because you have Mason Cone and you have Johnny Mullins. That is the one spot on the field right now that you could say is a distinct advantage for Syracuse coming into the day and what we're seeing early.
Three for three on face-offs, but just a 1-1 game, 6:20 to go. First quarter here in Charlotte, North Carolina. Place that is quickly becoming a hotbed for lacrosse. Mulet driven back out, gets free from his defender. That's Stabner, another Princeton transfer, flag down, delayed penalty on Hopkins.
Feeling that a lot of these players are slipping and sliding. Like, you just don't feel like they're planting their foot and they're confident with their change of direction.
Oh, buzz on Black. Black 28, interference 32nd.
I will get Stabner. He was on that final 14 with Sam English and Jake Stevens. If Matt Matalon, the Princeton head coach, is watching, he's probably thinking,
yes,
you can probably put together a top 10 team right now just on Princeton transfers.
Oh, you have Stevens, English, Stabner. You have
Vardaro.
Three guys at Michigan. Vardaro at Georgetown. A couple at Duke.
Slusher at Duke.
But Matalon's still winning. It tells you a lot about him as a coach.
Another man up chance for Syracuse. 0 for 1 today. Stevens hesitates. Whistle was the big man-up sniper last year. Hiltz shoots. Erlin got his stick on it. And it goes out of bounds, but it was kicked out by Syracuse. So Hopkins will get the ball back.
That was a phenomenal save by Chase Erlin. I mean, effortless, too. Tracking an Owen Hiltz shot from that angle when he drops his stick low. We've seen him shoot high, low, so it's a hard one to track in terms of when you turn on the tape and you see his tendencies. There was no guessing out of Erlin, and he gobbled that one up.
Erlin was sensational last week at Virginia. 16 saves in the win against the Cavs and really made some big stops in the second half.
Contrast for Hopkins and Syracuse. Syracuse is not deep at the short stick defensive midfield position.
Collison over to Melendez. He had a school NCAA tournament record 9 points in the first round win against Bryant last year. Former Marquette Golden Eagle. Now Collison. Down the alley, Mark stonewalls him right at the crease.
You see the strength and how easy it is for 16 in Black to get underneath his defender. Almost effortless, but you got to can that if you're Collison. You're high, your stick's high, the goalie's guessing high. Just shoot it right at Mark's ankles. Take another look at this left side of your screen here. If it pops, gets underneath, he just shows you how he's driving that left shoulder. That's one he's going to watch and say, should have scored that.
Roa wheels down the alley. He's picked up by the short stick of Avilas, his old teammate. Avilas had been Syracuse's top shorty the last couple of years. Roa wants the matchup. Avilas with great defense. And Spallina's got the backup for the Orange.
With the aggressive defense, it's going to be the Dodger, and it's going to have to be pass. I don't think that there's going to be a ton of the initial pass off the Dodge open.
Spallina using the pick and finds the back of the net. 2-1 Syracuse. Joey Spallina with his 22nd goal of the season to match his number.
If you turn on the tape and you watch Spallina, his lacrosse IQ is off the charts. His head is always up. He has the creativity, but he also knows how to play the pick game. Hopkins ties it up with Ayers, and then the super sophomore Spallina with a teammate's pick. He makes it count.
Some people just know that the best rate for you is a rate based on you with Allstate. Because you know that just because it fits in the cup holder doesn't make it to go. And you know how to break without breaking everything. And you're definitely not doing, okay, I don't even know what this is, but you're definitely not doing that. With Allstate, you're connected to a rate based on you.
Welcome to Total Wine. Doing okay?
Well, my buddy says rosé all day.
Good call. My personal fave is this new French rosé.
I love it already.
And we have it at the lowest price in town.
Whoa, great price on that rosé.
All day.
Find what you love. Love what you find. Only at Total Wine & More.
Is Gary Gate with his new defensive coordinator, John Oderna, came over from Manhattan, where he was the MAAC Coach of the Year last year for the Jaspers. 2-1 Syracuse here in the early going. Gary Gate, his brother Paul, remember Petro, Quint on the other side. Oh, yeah. Some great battles in the late 80s.
I was a fan in the stands. Bird Stadium in 1989 as an eighth grader watching Gary and Paul Gate against Quint and Dave Petromala. And
one of the best games of all time.
One of the best games of all time. And I was a complete lax rat by that time already. But it just took me even to another level.
You grew up in a place, Yorktown, New York, which in many ways was the offshoot epicenter of this rivalry.
Yes. Yeah, you grew up in Yorktown and your idols weren't Michael Jordan and Joe Montana. It was the Nelson brothers or Billy Dwan, and you wanted to be a Syracuse or a Hopkins lacrosse player. For me, it was Syracuse. From a younger brother, Brian, he wanted to be like Quint Kesnick.
3-1, Syracuse. That's two straight for the Orange. 2:50 to go in this opening quarter, and if you're the Blue Jays right now, you just need the ball. Owen Hiltz gets the tally.
I feel like when Owen Hiltz comes to the party and he's involved, this offense clicks to another level. It's interesting there. He got Erlen on the same shot where Erlen gobbled it up last possession. So he goes to his bread and butter lefty underhand, but he doesn't change the level. So maybe a guy like Erlen knows how good of a shooter Hiltz is. He's probably anticipating, since I saved him low, he's probably going to go high.
Another face-off one. Here's Mullen. Syracuse going quickly, and that one skirts wide from the wing by the Orange.
Johnny Mullen, the freshman face-off man from Massachusetts. He's only a freshman. Mark my words, in the next year or two, he will be at the top elite level nationally. He's got the build. He's got the athleticism. He has the stick skills with the new rules to make plays after a win. He checks every box, 36 of white.
Stevens turned away by Erlen. Quinton Kilrain, the freshman who's forced his way into the Hopkins starting lineup. A one-time Syracuse commit. He'll wag the dog all the way downfield, and Peter Millman says, we'll stop there and
we'll
call
a
timeout.
That's a great timeout. You have a freshman defender with the ball who was marvelous last week down in Charlottesville. Defended McCabe Millen. Top freshman in the country. Kilrain, one of the top-rated defenders in the country. He just checks every single box like a Mullen in terms of his upside. He's got the range. He's got the strength. He's got some mean streak in him.
.212 to go in this first quarter. Elsewhere in college lacrosse today, Notre Dame going to Ohio State, getting a 13-10 win against the Buckeyes. Loyola hung with Duke for about a half before the Blue Devils pulled away on the road in the second half. The Penn State-Cornell one was shocking. Yes. Penn State had that early loss to Colgate. They've been taking names since then.
Well, they just beat Yale last week when they were down 9-2, and this game was never in doubt. They were dominant the entire game against Cornell. The shocker of all shockers, though, the Maryland Brown game. Maryland comes in as a top five team, and you know they're clicking on all cylinders. Their only loss was Notre Dame. They've beaten Syracuse up in the dome. You think they're going to blow towards Brown, who's 0-4?
And had some ugly losses. Brown had some ugly losses leading up to that. This is what the top 10 looks like. Hopkins sitting at number 2. Denver at 5-0, and Denver, remember, has the Hopkins win. Army has picked up a couple of big wins. They beat Rutgers. They beat Syracuse. Notre Dame has the Maryland win, and they have the loss as well, losing to Georgetown.
You know what I love about this top 10? 5 weeks ago, before the season started, everyone thought it was Notre Dame, Virginia, Duke, and
in
everyone
some
else.
Order.
Guess what? It's everyone else. It's everyone else.
We're into March now, but the February slate provided a ton of theater this year. It is a long season, but there's a sense of urgency, more so for Syracuse in this game. You look at what they've done under Gary Gate. He's trying to get this program back. They only have one win in 14 games against top 10 opponents since Gate took over.
Yeah, that was Duke 2 seasons ago up in the dome. You feel like they're close, but close isn't good enough, right? You need validation.
Grimes moves it over from the wing. It is Degnan. That is 37 straight games with a goal for Garrett Degnan, who's now tied to the Johns Hopkins record shared by the great Terry Reardon and the great Ryan Brown.
There's been some amazing shooters in the left spot. Ryan Brown was a chameleon, can play both sides. Terry Reardon, and you think of all the great lefties that played at Johns Hopkins. Garrett Degnan, with his feet set, is darn right scary. He hammers the ball over 100 miles an hour. And watch his trajectory in terms of his release. He will change his levels. He will change where he shoots in terms of the location of the goal. So a guy like Will Mark has to stand in front of a Degnan shot. And it's not typical in terms of he does this every single time. He will spray it in a variety of ways. And if you're Syracuse, you cannot slide off of him. He's not the dodging threat. You can even put a short stick on him, but you have to shade him adjacent, because if he sets his feet, it's good night.
And if he gets to the left hand, goodbye. Procedure call on Tyler Dunn. Syracuse has won every faceoff. Here comes Michael Leo.
Look at the slides, right? This defense is aggressive.
Hiltz has a tally today, defended by a fellow 77, Hunter Jaronski. Smith came over to shade. Over to Leo again, working on Bowden Zulik, reigning Big Ten Defensive Player of the Week. 5 ground balls, 4 caused turnovers at Klockner last week.
And between him, Smith, and Kilrain.
Bouncer blocked. English tries to retrieve it. It'll stay in.
You look at this unit, and the way that their close defense has really risen to the occasion.
Thompson's got 2 helpers. English couldn't get anything on it. Zulik dislodged it, intercepted by Thompson. Syracuse off the scramble.
That
can't
happen.
Hold for one final shot.
That can't happen if you're Hopkins, because you're getting dominated at the faceoff X.
Leo didn't have an angle. Yeah, this is a Hopkins team that, again, through 6 games, clearing at 93%, and they've done it against a heavyweight schedule. Now in transition, Deans all the way, Mark with the stop. Final ticks. A catapult up ahead, And Syracuse able to pick it, unable to pick it clean, and it'll be Hopkins' ball with 1.8. Peschko puts one on Cage. Mark got a piece. It'll go as a save. And one quarter in the books. It's the Crown Lacrosse Classic here with the Queen City, Charlotte, North Carolina. The Kings of Lacrosse, Hopkins and Syracuse, 20 combined national titles in the NCAA era, meeting as top 10 teams together for the first time in 8 years.
Welcome to Total Wine. Doing okay?
My buddy says rosé all day.
My personal fave is this new French rosé.
I love it already.
Find what you love. Love what you find. Only at Total Wine & More.
I'm a guy who lost a bet and my dignity.
Get out of the way!
As if watching my team lose wasn't punishment enough. What are you looking at, huh? What are you... It's a one speed. If you have cut-rate car insurance, odds are you'd be paying for that yourself. So get Allstate and be better protected from mayhem, like me.
Hey, I'm walking here.
What's up, Auntie? Did you get the basketball shoes I need for tryouts this weekend?
Oh, dude, I'm not going to be able to make it to Dick's this week.
You can just click on Dick's.com.
Dick's.com.
Oh, welcome to Dick's.com.
Let me guess, you need to get the gear to save the day.
Wow, they're beautiful.
You want to compare it to the Red Sox and the Yankees? The memories that are conjured up when you hear Hopkins against Syracuse.
He gets the assist to tie his brother. He tied Casey.
Paul Rabel, Hopkins, best midfielder, and maybe the best offensive midi in the country.
With it, number 22, Gary Gay takes the best shot and scores.
And he fades the crease, a score and a goal! The game is over. Blue Jays have the impossible dream. They've won the NCAA championship 3 times in a row.
They've done it all this year in 1995.
Is always prologue when these two play, but these are also two programs that are starved when it comes to getting back on the national stage. Hopkins last won a title in 2007, last got the championship weekend in 2015. Syracuse last won a title in 2009, hasn't been to champ weekend since 2013. For two programs that at certain points in their history could have taken their team picture on Memorial Day weekend, that feels like forever.
Well, that's why when you hear the statement, we're back, it just infuses an alumni base like Kyle Harrison, who's in attendance, one of the greatest of all time, checking out his
Hall of Famer
beloved,
now.
Yeah, beloved Blue Jays. Look, Anish, at the end of the day, these fan bases just care more than everyone else. That's just the reality. The fan bases care, the schools care, the communities have always embraced lacrosse. It's a huge, huge deal on Saturdays in Baltimore around Homewood Field. It's a monster deal up in the Dome. It's their spring sport.
They get media coverage and attention locally the way Division I basketball teams do at certain schools. How about the nice stick work by Stevens? Gets to the middle, draws the attention. Trail check, Brett Martin, Hopkins, top shorty. Hurts comes back with it.
Hopkins has had 3 or 4 great trail checks. Like, once you think a Syracuse offensive player has penetrated the defense of the Blue Jays, they've been spectacular at getting behind the player with those trail checks, the timing of the trail checks.
Here is Burt Whistle, 49 career goals. Stevens, right hand free, fires.
There's
blocked.
Another one.
And Erlin able to clean up. Ahead to Martin, errant pass, rolling toward the near sideline. It'll stay in bounds, wet turf.
Hopkins has to clean up their clearing game. 4 for 7 in the first quarter, a team that's one of the best in the country at 92% coming into the game. they've really struggled against a Syracuse team that's dominating at the faceoff X. They have to clear up that aspect of their game.
Yeah, if you're Peter Millman right now, you're saying, if we can even out the possession battle, this probably becomes a different game. Here comes Peschko, 4 goals against Virginia, saved by Mark. Good sign for Syracuse. Will Mark against Army and Maryland, the two top opponents the Orange have played, you know, wasn't at his best. So I guess they're going to say that was not a shot clock reset. It didn't get a piece of Mark.
Looked like a save for me, and if it didn't hit his stick, it hit the pipe. I mean, that was blatantly, to me, a stop, unless it hit a defender on the way, but it looked like Mark made that stop.
Yeah, normally a save or a ball that hits the pipe that is recovered by the shooting team. Shot clock resets to 60. Here's Collison, big left hand. Mark stops this one. And then quickly outlets up ahead.
Both of these goalies have been seeing some serious heat and have answered the bell.
Mark is 5 out of 7. Erlin is 4 out of 7. Now Spallina wears that fabled number 22 worn by so many Syracuse greats, including his head coach Gary Gate.
Syracuse will do a lot to get some switches for Spallina, get a short stick, or also hang the defense up. So the wing dodge, which makes the adjacent show defensively where it gets a hang position.
Now Leo tried it, wanted Hiltz. He couldn't control it. Zulik the other way. Now it's Deans in transition. He's got 4 career goals, but he gives it up.
That last possession, when Leo is driving, he has Spallina behind the cage. The Hopkins defense is showing. Spallina's going to get the ball, and he's going to be able to hang the defender up, pick his spots, allow the cutters to come. Got to get the ball to Spallina there.
Ryan Evans now. They got English playing defense. Here comes Melendez. But a quiet start to the season to Peter Millman. Not concerned, he said Russell Melendez hasn't been forcing it. Here comes Hunter Chevette, and he ties the game. Hunter Chevette opened his Hopkins career as a freshman with back-to-back hat tricks. The last Hopkins freshman to do that, you got to go back to Mike O'Neill back in 1975.
Wow. And Chevette is a natural lefty attackman. Think Mac O'Keefe from Penn State, who plays for the Archers in the PLL. But right now, because of the seamless offensive approach by John Crawley and Peter Millman, they'll run him through the box, which allows him to stay above goal line and get these opportunities on short sticks, not dodging them, Anish, but actually shooting off of that pressure. When you have a shorty against an elite shooter like Chevette, he gets his hands free way easier.
Mullen against Logan Callahan. First faceoff win for the Blue Jays. It's Callahan from Victor, New York. There's a pretty good faceoff man who came out of Victor, New York, huh?
T.D. Erland, Jace's older brother.
Grimes the skip, Degnan the hammer.
You cannot treat Garrett Degnan when he's on the lefty wing like anyone else. You need to press out and understand he's one pass away from this. If you're Caden Cole and that's the assignment you have, you need to understand that. Have a head on a swivel. You can't show that much inside. If you're 33 and white, you don't show that much inside when you have maybe the best left-handed shooter with time and room in the country. I mean, he is salivating there. He's marinating on the left side, saying, I can't believe all this help is inside right now to let me spray.
Wings will get involved in this one. Alexo is going to get hit with a flag.
This is going to be interesting. If there's intent, it could go over 1 minute, Anish.
Are they going to look at two things, indirect, direct, or excessive and or flagrant? That applies to any hit to the neck and head area. And if it is indirect, it's non-releasable 1 minute. If it is a direct hit, according to the officials, 2 minutes. Something to note, both coaches agreed there would be no instant replay today. So we will not have replay in this game. This is a call where, under circumstances, when replay is available, you can look at it.
White number 48, cross check. Direct head and neck, 2 minutes full time.
That's what I thought. My initial reaction was it was not going to be a minute. There was going to be direct contact to the head, not indirect. And I think that's an easier call for the official also when you have that face-off scrum, right? It's almost like a defenseless player there. That's the right call.
So Johns Hopkins will have the man advantage for 2 minutes, 7 of 17 with the extra man this season.
See, the danger zone is when you have Chevette with Degnan, 34 in black and 40 in black. Both stretch shooters on the same side.
Degnan's got 19 career man-up goals. Melendez. They've got Angelus camped up top. Blue Jays probing the perimeter. Hunter Chevette, 9 goals on the season, 1 today. Melendez back to Angelus. Crease feed, Degnan hit the crossbar. The rebound comes back to Melendez. New 60. Still plenty of time on the extra man. Chauvet had his shot altered. Syracuse with the man down does almost a complete line change defensively.
Yes.
It's 5 new players who come in and all they do is play man down.
In isolation, it's a great concept.
Melendez, a little hesitation. Now Angelus. Degnan camped on that right wing. Can they get it to him with time and room? They did.
In isolation, it's a great concept because you get more players engaged. Your practice tempo and the ability to know you're going to get on the field, heightened awareness. The problem is after the penalty, you have guys that you probably aren't your premier cover guys stuck in the field.
Melendez with a bouncer. Mark got a piece of it. 38 seconds now on this extra man.
So if you hold, Riley Figueres won't be on Jacob Angelus. That's the danger zone.
Yeah, then you can't sub out when it's 6-on-6, but you're trying to get the stop when you're down a man. Melendez over to Degnan. Chevette spins it back to Angelus, now operating from X. Chevette, high to low. Mark gobbles it up. Low to high. Excuse me. Jordan Beck up ahead to Rois. Syracuse clears and we'll go back to even strength. That's a big penalty kill for the Orange.
Monster. And the belief of that clean unit that comes in to make the stop. You look up and on the sideline, there's a reason to celebrate.
Owen Hiltz had a hat trick against Hopkins last year. That was a Blue Jay win, however. Rose got the short stick, Jaronski. Throw off the invert. Plays catch with Hiltz. Now Spallina goes back to X. It comes to Stevens. Spallina guarded by Smith. Here's the double. Ball's on the ground. And we're going to get a whistle. Might be a loose ball push on somebody. And now it's getting heated. Spallina and Smith. It's a rivalry.
Prior to the flags and the chirping, that was an incredibly timed double, right? Smith is standing his ground on goal line extended. And the slide help from the backside. See the back of the helmet? That's your cue to go. See here, he posts up. Look at that slide help right there by Sululik. Then the aftermath. They'll always get the retaliation, Anish.
Yeah, they'll try to clean up this mess.
White 22. 2, conduct foul. 30 seconds. White, 31 black, in hold. 31 black, conduct as well. 30 seconds. Both are full time. Both are full time. 30, 30.
You got Spallina doing time, and then it looks like Melendez the in-home. But why isn't that Smith?
Well, did they just give Melendez full time for a hold? Yeah, take another look here.
There's no hold here. That's a great double.
I think the hold was earlier.
Yeah, the hold
could
have been earlier.
And then it was the double, the ball goes down.
And the ball's out, so it's a
loose. And then you see Smith kicks the stick. Spallina doesn't like it, and so they get into it. That easily draws the flag. Gary Gate will call a timeout.
The question is,
and I think Peter Milliman's trying to get an explanation.
Yeah.
If this is a full-time penalty on Melendez, if it's just a hold, that's not a full-time penalty.
Yeah, if it was unsportsmanlike, it could be full-time served. But just the hold, to your point, no. But my question, too, that was Spallina and Smith.
Unless they're not going to flag Smith, you're going to get the second guy, as we see quite often. Scott Smith, honorable mention, All-American last year. We saw what he did in the quarterfinals where he held Pat Kavanaugh to 1 point.
Scott Smith has become an elite defender nationally, because you look at Johns Hopkins' schedule, week in and week out. It's one top 10 team after another, and his assignment every single week is to defend everyone's alpha.
They opened with Denver. They played at Georgetown. They went on the road. They beat North Carolina. They beat Virginia on the road. This is their third straight ACC opponent that they are playing away from Homewood Field, technically neutral site. But just looking at the crowd here, I'd venture to say there's more Syracuse fans than Hopkins fans.
Yes. And I think the in-home, Melendez is being the player who's serving it, because it's a conduct foul on the team. It's a conduct foul on the team. It's not Melendez who made the penalty here. So anytime it's a team foul, your in-home serves. That's why Melendez is in there. I'm still
and that
curious.
Would explain why it's full time.
Yes.
They just didn't explain that. So both teams will play 5-on-5. It'll be Syracuse ball. What's important with 5-on-5 offense when you have more spacing?
Well, you could go open set here. And the beauty of it is Jamison Kester's base defense and their slide rotation is predicated on 6 players, too. So your slide rotations are different. But I think it gives your midfielders way more room to operate. If you go open set, you're going to force an adjacent slide as opposed to the crease.
Throw up marked by Martin. Erland gets a piece to turn it away. Rolling toward midfield. 2-on-1 ground ball for Hopkins. Kicked up ahead. Then it comes back. And it's Jaronski off the ground. Unsettled chance for the Blue Jays. Bauer. Turbos. One more. Degnan. Doorstep saved by Mark.
Mark's been on. Chase Erland's been on. We have a goalie battle, Anish.
Degnan guarded by Caden Cole.
Yeah, that's the spot you don't need to worry about Degnan too much. Worry about him when he doesn't have the ball, because they're going to get it to him with time and room. And you saw his ability to absolutely have the ball screaming out of his stick.
Melendez going to work on the shorty. Melendez slams on the brakes over to Degnan. Bauer plays it up top. They love using Angelus all over the field. He's not just the next guy. Peshko, that one hit the pipe. Resets the shot clock at 60. Bauer's speed demands a pole. And he gets one from Riley Figueres, the redshirt freshman. highly recruited, highly rated, missed all of last season with a lower body injury. Angeles now against the short stick. Slide's got to come.
You watch Angeles, too. I love how his head is always up surveying the defense.
No slide yet. Angeles, the skip pass. Now Bauer. Working on Vinny Trujillo. Flag down. Hopkins will go man up. Degnan, lefty free. And the Blue Jays will have their power play unit back on.
On the hold here. Got him a little high too. Dylan Bauer, who's got the turbo jets, as you mentioned. The equalizer here, though, for Syracuse is actually the turf. It's slowing a guy like Bauer down.
Neither team has scored on the extra man so far. Degnan is an assassin. If he scores here, it'll be his 20th career EMO goal. Angeles up top. Degnan missed the cage. Boy, he's been getting some looks in what is his sweet spot for
yes.
a natural lefty.
You know, we talk about the wet turf being the equalizer on a guy like Dylan Bauer. Degnan just needs to plant his feet. He's not trying to plant a foot and separate as a Dodger. You have to extend out to him. Don't treat him the same as everyone else.
One of the great goal scorers in the history of Hopkins lacrosse. Coming off back-to-back 40-goal seasons. Bounce shot. That one misses.
They're playing with fire. Like he's getting his shots here. Like, Syracuse needs to regroup, and they need to identify where Degnan is, because he will make them pay. I mean, you think of some of the great shooters that have worn the Syracuse orange or the Hopkins blue. Degnan's coming to the party and
Live Sports. ESPN Plus Originals. The exclusive home of the complete 30 for 30 library.
The moment I loved our Subaru Outback most was the moment they walked away from it.
Mom! Oh, thank goodness.
And that's why our family will only drive a Subaru.
Subaru. More IIHS Top Safety Pick Plus Awards than any other brand. Love. It's what makes Subaru, Subaru.
Today, I'm excited to show you... I'm the... Let's dive in.
Johns Hopkins with a one-goal lead on Syracuse here in Charlotte, North Carolina at the Crown Lacrosse Classic. It is a top-10 matchup that is oh so close to potentially being one versus two.
Absolutely. J.J. Silstrop, though, in the first week of February, made his presence felt with four of the last goals for Denver. The Pioneers were 13th that date. Now they're number one. Maryland went up to the Dome in a classic in mid-February. Stamos with the winner, the short stick D-Mitty, and heartbreak once again for Cuse. They have the two top five overtime losses. This could be one versus two, Anish.
Yeah, Denver, again, was down a goal with less than 2 seconds to go in regulation, got the equalizer against Maryland. Replay looked at a potential goal by Syracuse. The call on the field was no goal. Replay held that up. That was in overtime. Maryland then won. But when Syracuse fell asleep on defense and against Army, Syracuse had a chance in OT on an empty net. Could not score. Here comes Bauer. He missed the cage. Mark sprang out. They were trying to get it to Degnan. Shot clock down to four, down to three, and that turnover probably did Hopkins some good.
It'll be interesting to see the way that Syracuse attacks now, because we've seen the really aggressive approach by Hopkins defensively. They're sliding before the Syracuse offensive players are demanding a slide, right? They are forcing Syracuse to move the ball quickly, but that's kind of Syracuse's strength. You know, I love the style of Jamison Kresser in terms of how he always plays aggressive, but against this team that passes so well, is playing that aggressive the call?
Well, it's worked so far. Syracuse has not scored since the 250 mark of the opening quarter. They turn it over here. Orange scoreless in the second quarter. They had a 3-1 lead. It's been three straight by the Blue Jays. Thompson's got a couple of helpers. Picked up by the short stick, Jaronski. Part of maybe the best rope unit in all of college lacrosse. English over to Leo, the backup to Syracuse, and Spallina, who's been quiet in this first half.
Here's the matchup. Here comes a pick by Muley. You get the switch now. So now Muley Syracuse the has the ball. He pays the price, but it was well worth it because now Joey Spallina has the short stick. Hopkins will be sliding quickly.
Cat and mouse, Spallina feeding in front. His intended target whiffed. Leo is down. Blue Jay long sticks in there. Popped into the air. Dean's got a stick on it. Shovels it ahead. Angeles missed it. Peshko had it. Figueres knocked it away. It somehow stays in bounds. It's a scramble. Jaronski looking for Kilrain. He gets destroyed by DeJuan. A flag goes up. Now, Billy DeJuan plays with some ferocity. And you talk about a guy whose family is a big part of this rivalry. Dad was a Yorktown guy, played at Johns Hopkins. Longtime Dave Petromalo assistant for the Blue Jays.
Billy DeJuan is an incredible coach and friend of mine who spent so many years at Hopkins.
White, number 35, unnecessary roughness, 1 minute foul.
The DeJuans, when you think of Billy DeJuan, Billy DeJuan III's father, who you were mentioning, played so physical at Johns Hopkins. His uncle, Robbie Dorr, who played at Johns Hopkins, so physical. They're going to make you pay every single time. His uncle, Matt DeJuan, who played at Loyola, it's in their DNA.
I think of those great Hopkins defenses. You had DeJuan and Petro back there, and then Kesnick didn't stop talking.
You see the physicality of Billy DeJuan III, too, and if you know the family, they have a hockey fighting library that rivals any family hockey fighting library out there.
Man up chance here for Hopkins, trying to get it inside. Chevette can't get the shot off. Degnan spins it to Collison. Hunter Chevette again, and Mark is right there. The freshman telegraphed his move.
You know, when you lay the boom like Billy DeJuan III, you're sending a message to this rivalry, but also when you come across the middle, you're going to feel it.
Remember, you can go over and back in the first 20 seconds of the shot clock.
Syracuse has been successful finding switches off the pick with Spallina. And a lot of times when he gets that shorty matchup, every team is so quick to slide that he can find spots and become an easy feeder behind the cage because all eyes are on him to support the matchup.
Neither team has scored on the man up. 0 for 5 combined. Hopkins 0 for 3. Syracuse 0 for 2. Both goalies have been terrific in this first half. Low scoring game. It hasn't been a slow paced game.
It's been sloppy. A lot of missed passes. Knockdowns. Like we haven't seen a clean version offensively, really, from either team.
A part of it, you're waiting around to play all day, and let's be honest, you have three games prior to this on the same field. Nobody going into today was quite sure when the game would actually start when you take the field.
Well, we were kind of going back and forth with our own guesses.
Would you have 702?
My second guess was really close, but our producer, John Kettering, made me stick to my first guess, which was 730.
730. When I talked to Gary Gate when they were practicing yesterday, he thought 8 o'clock.
And he knows a thing or two about how long games could go and being behind a women's game, too, which sometimes can run, you know, 2:30, 2:45.
The folks here, led by Chris Schiller, have really put on a terrific event for many years. The Crown Lacrosse Classic continues to draw top teams. The last time Peter Millman was here for the Crown Classic, 2020, Cornell, Penn State, Jeff Teat had the game-tying goal. Angelo Petrakis won it. And then after that game, everything shut down and the season was canceled. It was the last game before COVID canceled sports.
I remember watching that. I think you were on the field watching it, weren't you?
I was there live. It was not far from here. It wasn't played at this stadium. Here's Angeles. About a second differential. Game clock and shot clock. Melendez on the run. Degnan looking for his third. 4.3 on the game clock. 3 seconds on the shot clock. And a low-scoring first half. Peter Millman wants a timeout. Well, Denver drew something up at 1.7, so what does Hopkins draw up here?
We'll get the proper ball location, but the beauty of this is I would start with Jacob Angeles because he's the best passer on the team. And you have so many crafty sticks with Degnan and Chevette. I would put Degnan and Chevette on the field together because with 4.3 seconds, you might have to shoot from the outside. And if you run some kind of a pick with Degnan and Chevette, two lefty hired guns, you've got an option there in terms of the pick game and slipping underneath the pit or going above it.
Story of the game so far, both goalies have been fantastic. And while Syracuse dominated possession early on, Johns Hopkins defense came to play.
Yeah, a lot of people think when you play Syracuse, don't slide, make them beat you one-on-one because of their ball movement. Well, defensive coordinator Jamison Kesterer has slid quickly with force, and the timing of these doubles I think have been spectacular. Every time a Syracuse offensive player is ready to go, there is a defender from Hopkins, almost like a free safety, roaming, ready to support. So the timing of all this, you can implement a sliding rotation type defense, but if the timing of it isn't great, you're going to get picked apart against a passing team like Syracuse. But the timing has been spectacular. They've been doubling behind offensive players who don't see it from behind. I think this guy's done a tremendous job in the first half.
It's a stingy defense anchored by the Cornell transfer, Erlen. Angeles marked by Alexo. Final ticks. Angeles. Time runs out, and we go to halftime. Syracuse jumped out to a 3-1 lead. Hopkins closed the first half with three straight, holding Syracuse without a goal in the second quarter. But hang on, are they putting time back on the clock? The horn sounded, but the players are still on the field. And the clock is showing triple zeros right now. So they've added a tenth of a second.
They'll huck it the entire length of the field. Sam Alexo.
Alexo heaves it down just a bit outside. And now Gary Gate wants an explanation. Yeah, so the issue seems to be the horn blew before
clock
time had expired.
Take a look here. Left side of your screens, the game clock. The shot clock violation before the game clock expires, but the horn sounds before both of them.
Yeah, there was a second differential. Halftime coming up. Karg and Charlotte North discuss style. Who's got the best swag? on the field in college lacrosse and in this Syracuse-Hopkins rivalry. That's coming up.
Live sports. ESPN Plus Originals.
Someday, I'll be the first female president of the universe.
Someday, I'm gonna marry my baseball glove. Probably in Vegas.
There are a lot of miles between today and someday. Your long-lasting three-row Subaru Ascent will get your family there.
96% of Subaru vehicles sold in the past 10 years are still on the road.
Someday, I'll be able to read dogs' minds. He's thinking squirrels.
Get 2.9% APR financing on a new 2024 Subaru Ascent. Going on now.
My daughter says she works in B2B, where she sells SEO and MRM to CPGs. I don't know how this happened. She was speaking in complete sentences before she was two.
Parents don't get B2B marketing. LinkedIn does. LinkedIn is the place to be to be.
I have had many cars over the years. I make sure they're well maintained. But sometimes you just run into a faulty car with problems. If you have a car with problems, call my Lemon Law Lawyer now. When your car stops working, they start working. Visit them at mylemonlawlawyer.com. They get the manufacturers to cover your costs. You pay zero.
If you have a 2018 to 2024 vehicle with problems, call now. Perhaps you just bought it from the dealership and you're having problems. You need to call my Lemon Law Lawyer now. You pay zero. That's right, zero.
The quest begins at the ACC tournament.
It's showtime right now. I mean, it is showtime.
I'm taking a toss, I'm wrecking a land. I keep it hardcore like a real fan. These are the roughest, toughest ones I ever wrote. And I always put on a show where the hearts land.
And that is the exclamation point.
My voice is raw, my lyrics is long. This is the best tournament that you ever saw.
It's what they play for and dream about all their lives.
Imaginative freedom is the soul stone of lacrosse. And for the great ones, their stick is like a paintbrush. Style and swagger is on the canvas in this episode of The Cross with Kark and Charlotte North.
Your game has some style. You agree?
I'd like to think so.
Who else has style with a stick in their hand?
Favorite category in lacrosse, favorite thing to learn about a player. I'm gonna go with Pat Kavanaugh, Notre Dame men's lacrosse.
I like it.
His style has some flair to it. It has creativity, it has excitement, it has passion, but I love that he plays like he's in the backyard, especially with his brother, Chris Kavanaugh, on the offensive end. But he has a way of reading pressure, reading a defender, feeling where the pressure is on his top side, backside, wherever it may be. He can get that stick away from his body. He can throw a behind the back pass around the world, backhanded, you name it, between the legs. He'll do things that'll make your jaw drop, but they're with good reason because he's practicing them in the backyard and he can read where a defense pressures him.
I'm gonna stay with the national champ, Aaron Kuykendall from Northwestern. You know, Izzy Skane won the Tourton a year ago, rightfully so. She's an absolute beast of a player. But Aaron Kuykendall, for me, stylistically, the way that she plays, how good her hands are, how she sees the field as a passer as well, is kind of off the charts. But the thing for me that kind of puts the cherry on top in regards to Kuykendall is her behind the back. I think she has the best behind the back pass and shot in college lacrosse, whether it's men's or women's. I know there's some others that might argue. Pat Kavanaugh being one, Joey Spallina being another. But Aaron Kuykendall, that BTB has a mixture of like style and force.
My favorite part about Aaron's game, her behind the back fake. Ooh. She gets a whole defense to turn their head and look at where that ball's going, but she gets them on that and she gets it every time. I love watching her play.
And this rivalry between Syracuse and Hopkins, boy, it's had its share of artists.
Oh yeah, Mike Springer for my money, the hardest shooter. They call him the stealth bomber. Shot about 110 miles an hour, run for cover when he has it in the right hand. Ryan Brown, smoothest shooter I've ever seen. He did it with both hands. Six release points in each. Underhand, sidearm, overhand, right and left. Paul Gate behind the back. Turn on the tape, 1989. The best pass in lacrosse history against Quint Kesenick and the Blue Jays. Mike Powell, he was like Allen Iverson with a lacrosse stick. So quick and electric. But the one player who could erase all of these guys, Petro, Dave Petromala.
IQ didn't make the list, huh?
No.
I had him as quirkiest. That's legendary status in some circles.
Welcome to Total Wine. What can I help with?
My sister's hosting a party, and she's big on tequila. What's like a really good one?
I just had this Reposado last week. Amazing.
I love it already.
And that is the lowest price anywhere.
Whoa, that's a low price.
Better make it two then.
Find what you love. Love what you find. Only at Total Wine and More.
You know, we talked about everything. His hopes, his dreams, his fears, even his secrets.
Not a lot of people know this, but the Gecko is actually left-handed.
You can see by the way he holds the microphone when he comes to the podium.
He made it easy with only his left hand.
What hand he chooses to use as his dominant hand, that's his business and no one else's.
On one hand, it's so helpful to find the right coverage with Geico.
On the other hand, who cares?
Well, I care.
From cars to home to jewelry, it's easy to Geico.
Someday, I'll be the first female president of the universe.
Someday, I'm gonna marry my baseball glove, probably in Vegas.
There are a lot of miles between today and someday. Your long-lasting three-row Subaru Ascent will get your family there.
96% of Subaru vehicles sold in the past 10 years are still on the road.
Someday, I'll be able to read dogs' minds. He's thinking squirrels.
Get 2.9% APR financing on a new 2024 Subaru Ascent. Going on now.
Halftime continues here at American Legion Stadium in Charlotte, North Carolina. First top 10 matchup between Johns Hopkins and Syracuse since 2016. Blue Jays up by one.
Welcome to Total Wine. What can I help with?
My sister's hosting a party and she's big on tequila. What's like a really good one?
I just had this Reposado last week. Amazing.
I love it already.
And that is the lowest price anywhere.
Whoa, that's a low price.
Better make it two then.
Find what you love. Love what you find. Only at Total Wine and More.
You know, we talked about everything. His hopes, his dreams, his fears, even his secrets.
Not a lot of people know this, but the Gecko is actually left-handed.
You can see by the way he holds the microphone when he comes to the podium.
He made it easy with only his left hand.
What hand he chooses to use as his dominant hand, that's his business and no one else's.
On one hand, it's so helpful to find the right coverage with Geico.
On the other hand, who cares?
Well, I care.
From cars to home to jewelry, it's easy to Geico.
She's got the sugar rush for the second half. That's tough on the parents after the game. But for now, we're getting ready for the start of the second half here in Charlotte. Johns Hopkins with a one-goal lead on Syracuse. Hopkins looking to go 3-0 in this ACC gauntlet. They beat UNC. They beat Virginia. Now leading Syracuse early in this game. Clark, Syracuse dominated possession. They couldn't quite translate that into a lot of goals.
Yeah, sloppy play and a swarming Hopkins defense. I think the timing of their slides in terms of Jamison Kester's unit has been so cohesive. But if you're Syracuse, you know you could win the face-off battle at the X. You have to start hitting in transition a little bit too, because the 6-on-6 settled defense, they haven't been able to penetrate that.
Yeah, we haven't seen much from Joey Spallina. He's got a goal, but he's been quiet otherwise, hasn't touched it a whole lot. The Orange got on the board early. It was Mulet.
Yeah, Mulet with a beautiful backhand behind the back and some great creativity in the Crown City. Jimmy Ayers, the freshman from Massachusetts, has a tremendous future. The goalies have also been spectacular. That's why this score is 4-3. Will Mark and Chase Erland have answered the bell. It's the outside shooting, though, of Garrett Degnan. If you are a Syracuse lacrosse fan, every time he has the ball, you cringe because the ball's moving over 100 miles an hour, and he's getting his spots. They're giving him the time and room. So if they continue to allow 40 and Black that much time to operate in terms of catching, shooting, it's going to be a long night.
It's interesting that the shots are even because Johns Hopkins did not take a shot early in the game when Syracuse had already taken 8 shots. But in the second quarter, no possession changed. The Blue Jays had the ball more. Faceoffs have been an advantage for Syracuse, but in a low-scoring game, that's minimized.
Yeah, and you see the wet track, too. A lot of these players are having a tough time in terms of finding their footing. There's been some blown clears, and this is the fourth game. I watched the women's game prior to this one between Stony Brook and Hopkins Women's. Hopkins Women's with a big, big win against a team in Stony Brook that beat Syracuse up in the Dome earlier in the week. I didn't see the same kind of footing issues when the women were playing in the prior game. This game, though, these players are slipping and sliding all over this track.
Mason Cohn, the Division III transfer from Tufts, facing off against Logan Callahan. Callahan moved early, and here comes Cohn. Played hockey and lacrosse at Tufts. This is the first time he has spent a whole year focusing on just lacrosse. I was talking to him yesterday, and Jake Stevens and Joey Spallina were standing by, and they were laughing. They couldn't believe it. Here comes Finn Thompson. Over to Hill, slow to high. Erland got a piece. You think about Cohn, he's not facing off for some no-name program. He's facing off for Syracuse as the number one guy. And again, he was mostly a hockey player growing up.
Well, you know what that tells you, though? There's a lot of tread on the tire with Mason Cohn. You have a 1-2 punch with Johnny Mullins, too. So if Syracuse can figure a way to get some wins against quality opponents, those guys will be fresh in May if there's a playoff potential run.
Good ball movement. Hiltz missed the cage. And Thompson will dig it out for Syracuse. So Thompson, who's got 2 assists, doing a lot of initiating today. As Hopkins' close defense has put the shackles for the most part on Mulet and Spallina. Hiltz had a good feed, but no shot there. Still plenty of time to shoot. Here comes Mulet. There's that well-timed slide. Zulik that time came over. Got an open man right on the crease. Shot and a score. It is Joey Spallina tying the game at 4.
I've talked to a lot of people about Joey Spallina in terms of his lacrosse IQ. He doesn't have to be the guy that pulls it out and tells everyone in the stadium he's dodging. He's so good off ball. Understands spacing, shot location, and faking a goalie. This is patented Owen Hiltz. Skip passer extraordinaire. To on the doorstep, Joey Spallina. A lot of people think quarterback dodger. He has that off-ball element. Get him involved as a guy who could finish inside.
First goal in almost 20 minutes for Syracuse.
Now you gotta have a variety of ways to get a guy like Spallina involved, because not all the time is he gonna own a one-on-one matchup against a guy like Scott Smith, but he has the lacrosse IQ to beat players off ball. And there's passers around him.
There's Jackson Birtwistle. Row up, spinning around. Dusting Jaronski, finding Mulet. Make it, take it, lacrosse.
When you're really aggressive on defense, a lot of times, Anish, you want to support the dodger. You want to support that matchup. Luke Rowe is the dodger. The support, look at all the eyes of the Hopkins defense. They're all upfield. All Cam Mule has to do is stand his ground. He has the seam already. You see him kind of itching for the ball because the eyes of the defense are on Roa. That's when an aggressive defense can come back to haunt you. You're so concerned about the support.
Christian Mule. A lot of Mule's out there too, right?
Did we call him Cam, his brother?
Did we call him Cam? Cam played at Duke.
I've mixed those guys up, and I've known them for so long. And not only phenomenal lacrosse players, incredible teammates.
Yeah.
Cam was a favorite in the locker room for Duke for many years. Graduated in 2022. And Christian on his fifth year from Lehigh. And Johnny on the spot tonight with two beautiful goals.
Here comes Hiltz. Three in a row for Syracuse. They're scoring, they're winning faceoffs, they're taking it back downfield and scoring again. And they've got Johns Hopkins milling in retreat right now.
Do you know if you're a Syracuse fan, you're worried about Degnan getting his touches? If you're a Hopkins fan, you're watching the way that this offense is matriculating and finding spots. Who's the player on Syracuse that's getting these step downs? It's Owen Hiltz. 77 can make you pay.
Live sports.
Someday, I'll be the first female president of the universe.
Someday, I'm gonna marry my baseball glove. Probably in Vegas.
There are a lot of miles between today and someday. Your long-lasting three-row Subaru Ascent will get your family there.
96% of Subaru vehicles sold in the past 10 years are still on the road.
Someday I'll be able to read dogs' minds. He's thinking squirrels.
Get 2.9% APR financing on a new 2024 Subaru Ascent. Going on now.
Get the right oil for the right price at AutoZone. Right now, you can get 5 quarts of STP conventional or high mileage with an STP oil filter for only
$26.99.
Let's rethink fashion. Make secondhand your first choice. Spend less on things you'll love more. When you're over it, sell it. Do it over and over again. It's easy. Look good, feel good too. Shop resale, not retail. Get on Depop.
The most passion, the most intensity. This is the way basketball's supposed to be.
Beautiful look at Uptown Charlotte. Three goals in about a minute for Syracuse.
I think there's been some adjustments made. You know, the midfield and the up top offense has the eyes of the Hopkins defense thinking they're going to initiate Luke Roa. The intent doesn't have to be to go to the goal as a goal scorer. Just get the Hopkins defense thinking you're going to the cage. This is an aggressive unit, and Pat Marks, the offensive coordinator, obviously made some adjustments at half to counter Jamison Kesser, the defensive coordinator. There's Marks in the orange hat. Next to Gary Gate. But how do you beat an aggressive defense, Anish? It's with passing and kind of lulling a defense to think that you're going to the cage as a dodger, but it's a passer intent.
Johns Hopkins finally gets the ball. Syracuse had won 10 out of 12 faceoffs prior to that last one. Mullen, the freshman, had taken it. Now the Blue Jays will get into their settled set. Peschko out there with Collison. And Bauer, Angeles, Melendez, those guys will yo-yo from midfield to attack. A lot of these pieces on the top six interchangeable. Melendez over to Degnan.
He's the missing piece, I think, tonight. He's getting a short stick on him every time, 31 in black. He has to maximize these matchups.
Matt Wright, the UNC transfer, former All-American a few years ago, was on Degnan. Here's Collison. Puts one on Cage, stings the corner. This guy's a freshman last year. Scored 26 goals Since 1980, the only freshman midfielders at Hopkins who scored more goals in a season, Joel Tinney and Del Dressel.
Wow. I mentioned the open that'll shoot right through you. He's a Canadian from Ontario. He's 6'4", 225. He kind of has an old-school American north-south dodging aspect to his game. Doesn't need to go underneath like a lot of Canadians. He just soaks the body pressure, and he can shoot through you. He's such an intriguing prospect because a lot of times Dodgers and initiators need separation to get a goal. He doesn't. He's so strong, he shoots through you. And on a righty goalie, that thing just stung the opposite pipe.
How about Cone? Turbines out of the ambush. Another faceoff won by the Orange. Now Spallino waits for Smith. Gets it to Stevens. Trying to maneuver on Deans. Good recovery. Rowe is going to run out of the box.
So Christian Mulet is behind the cage. They've been short-sticking him.
And they're leaving Cone out there, which means Callahan is out there for Hopkins. Cone's going to set the pick. Spallina uses it. Now Callahan runs off. Spallina, that one is saved by Erlin, and now Cone will run off, and both teams will have their personnel.
It's a smart move by Syracuse.
Why?
Because Cone is more athletic than Callahan. He's more comfortable with the ball in his stick, and you could trap a guy like Callahan where you have other options, and if you go back to the faceoff X, you have a fresh Johnny Mullins waiting.
Rowe has been a catalyst. Spallina chased by Zulik. Spallina, that inside roll wasn't there. Triple teamed. That means somebody's open. Flag down. Hiltz, crease feed. Stevens, dunk.
There's something very subtle here I want you to watch, Anish. Watch when Jake Stevens catches the ball. There's a slight hesitation in his fake. He knows that if he continues to move in that same direction, he's going to get the goalie, Erlin, to go with him. Spallina understands the crease in that location, not stepping in. And there's the through pass extraordinaire once again to his Canadian mate, Jake Stevens. He catches this ball, he continues. And then he throws the fake. That is an elite goal-scoring inside finisher in Jake Stevens.
We'll be watching him in the PLL this summer.
Yes, he's going to be playing professional lacrosse for a long time, and you get a chameleon of a midfielder. Play him on wings. They didn't have him in the West Point Army game, right? If they have Jake Stevens in an overtime game where he's so significant in terms of the way he impacts the game on the wings on faceoffs and in transition, scoring goals.
Faceoff won that time by the junior Callahan. Hopkins has yet to put a shot on goal in this quarter. Almost 5 minutes in. Grimes has a couple of helpers. He's got Trujillo, the short stick. Little two-man game with Angeles. Syracuse recovers on the big little. Figueres jarred it loose. And Hopkins still without a shot on cage.
We've been praising Hopkins' defensive slides. That's the best slide I've seen from Syracuse tonight. In terms of Grimes coming upfield, not understanding the backside pressure of that slide, it was timed.
That first midfield of Thompson, English, and Leo, who's got the ball for Syracuse. Thompson against Raposo. They wanted Mulet. Good idea by Spallina. Bad execution. I'm talking to Joey Spallina yesterday. He understands when you wear 22 in the age of social media, when you play at Syracuse, you're going to be in the crosshairs. And yeah, he laughed about it. I said, hey, you get a lot of stuff thrown your way. But listen, part of it, he knows it comes with the territory when that's a failure to advance. They couldn't get it across.
That's where a soft ride can really frustrate a team that's clearing, because you think you have so much time, and then they start jumping you when you're in between the restraining box and the midfield line. So Syracuse kind of just goes soft to hard right there once the clock is in their favor in terms of clearing.
Now, Peter Milliman was yelling that Michael Leo was on the field when he should not have been, and the officials missed it. That might have been an offsides on Syracuse.
I think Syracuse right now, they're having success when some of their midfielders, players from up top, are dodging with the intent to pass.
Spallina, feet in front, push from the back, shot and a score. It's Mule again, and the orange sideline juiced.
Christian Mule is a gamer. He's got ice in his veins. Scored the tying goal against Maryland up in the dome to force that game into overtime. It's the ride, it's the relentless approach that gives this Syracuse offense another opportunity. And Christian Mule with his third of the game. He's been so strong inside. Tell you what, when he gets back up to Long Island this summer, Uncle Ray's gonna be feeding him some chicken cutlets with this game.
Hopkins came into the game clearing at 93%. Today, below 65%. Uncharacteristic. Cohn wins the faceoff. Tries to play it to the wing. Spallina able to retrieve. Hopkins using that sideline as an extra defender. Stevens dusting his man. He's Da Vinci in cleats. Stevens all the way to the rack. Trail check by Deans. Loose ball near the crease. Smith has it. And gets it back to Earl. A nice play by Scott Smith, the All-American. Here comes Kilrain. Degnan back to McDermott. He's a two-way middie.
If you're Hopkins, the options here. You have Angelus, who's your conductor, your quarterback. But this guy, Collison, on a shorty, it's green light all day long.
Angelus only one assist today. He's Hopkins' leading scorer. Peschko, quiet after a four-goal outing at Klockner last week. Bauer's got some shake. Park City, Utah, cashes in.
Dylan Bauer's pretty two-handed. He's also as quick as a hiccup. And on a wet field, finding his footing has been tough. Not this time, though. You see the acceleration, the way that he gets the defender to bite. Watch his right plant foot here. Once he does this, the hips just completely open up, and it is go time.
And Nick Kakemo that time lost his footing, and Bauer, too fast, you're not gonna recover.
It's the strong plant foot. He sizes the defender up, he squares the defender up, but that hard plant foot with the right gets Kakemo to go one way, and he doesn't have the footing to match hips.
A loose ball hold against Syracuse, so Callahan has done a nice job at least mucking it up a little bit when he's been in there against Cohn and Mullen.
That's a great point. We're seeing some adjustments all over this field. One on the faceoff X that you mentioned with Callahan. We see offensive coordinator Pat March for Syracuse employing way more passing in the offense, less dodging. What are the adjustments offensively right now for this Hopkins offense?
They've got Angelus on the short stick, English. Feed in front, Peschko whiffs.
Gotta be careful there, Anish. If Angelus has a shorty and he's not beat, when you slide to him early, his eyes are always up. He's gonna find someone on the doorstep.
It goes to Syracuse. Alexo has 11 goals, and they're gonna get English for trying to use his hand. They're using his hand. And now a quick restart. How about the trail check? Mule knocks it away, Peschko was not looking. Hold on. Now they're going to blow the whistle. Offsides.
He thinks he had someone back, Gary Gate. You know Mule went over. But that's okay as long as you exchange here. C see if we could get another look at this. Left side of your screen. Muley, you see him hustling. He goes over. Yeah, it looked like Carter Rice through the substitution box.
Now, we couldn't see the other end of the field how many guys were down there, but Gary Gate was pleading the case. Here comes Bauer. Carter Rice defending him. Trujillo driving Degnan to his right hand. Degnan spins him around and makes it 8-7, a hat trick for Garrett Degnan.
He's feeling it. Six-year senior's balling. We know about him from the outside, stretching the defense. Garrett Degnan is 6'4". Vinny Trujillo is about 5'9", so he gets into the body, but this is a sweet move. Thinking that he's going upfield potentially to pass or shoot, gets the defense of Trujillo to bite, and all the eyes and the support's going upfield. So once he beats Trujillo, there's no help.
And you saw Trujillo was playing the scouting report. He was overemphasizing
lefty, lefty,
the left.
Lefty,
left, 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 and Degnan pulled a veteran move on him.
But what that fake did, Anish, he got the entire defense to shift upfield, so once he got underneath, there was no support.
Callahan went early. Another face-off to Syracuse. One goal game. Now, Hopkins this season, they've banked wins against Georgetown, North Carolina, and Virginia. They've played arguably the toughest schedule in college lacrosse. They've got one of the, if not the best resumes, even with the one loss. For Syracuse, a 5-2, it's a much improved team. The close losses to Maryland and Army. But right now, there's nothing on the Syracuse resume that plays on Selection Sunday.
No, and you're running out of these non-conference opportunities, right? You have Cornell down the road. You have Delaware.
Still got the ACC. But the bulk of your games, because of renovations to the Dome, a front-loaded schedule, they're going to be on the road
straight.
The rest of the way.
They're going to be.
This is the first time Syracuse has played outside of Central New York. Erland stops the shot.
That looked like a just standard save, but that was actually beautiful. Like, he played the angle. He didn't bite, because when you're dealing with a Canadian, they're going to move you pipe to pipe. And then he made that save across his face on Sammy English.
This game has always had intensity, but the stakes feel different this year.
They do. Because of the preseason hype, right? The magazine covers.
Back.
We're back.
Here comes Ayers, the speedy freshman, out of the box. Him and Bauer both out there can create matchup problems for the Blue Jays. Ayers over to Degnan, and that one hums just wide.
The way that this offense is working tonight, I would probably put more of number four in Black out there. I think he could beat his man. He could own a matchup.
He started on attack in the fall. And Ayers ties the game with the outside howitzer. 8-8 in the Queen City.
Hopkins returned this season, their top 11 point scorers. Getting a freshman on the field after the six-year senior Chase Erland gobbles one up. It's a daunting task. Who are you going to replace? Whose minutes are you going to take? Jimmy Ayers doesn't care. He is maximizing every opportunity. And if you flash too far to him, watch how he will change direction. Right there, he didn't have to. He had all the time in the room to set his feet. But this kid is going to be a star.
Top 25 recruit coming out of high school and really made a name for himself in that Carolina game where he had a couple of goals. He's got two today. We're tied at 8. Hopkins has responded after a 5-1 Syracuse run, 3 straight by the Blue Jays.
Hey.
Here's Bert Whistle. 49 career goals, zero assists. Roa up high. He's on the Carcaterra meal plan. He eats.
I knew you were going
he
there.
He eats.
I played with too many good passers.
Inside roll. We're going to get a flag.
It's amazing how he kept that ball on a stick.
Erlin, another save. Smith pokes it away. Penalty coming on Hopkins. Spallina will reset. He's got a short stick matchup. He wants a clear out. Feed on the doorstep. Another goal for the Orange. And that ends a 3-0 run by Johns Hopkins.
You get ways to get 22 the ball. Doesn't have to be the one-on-one matchup. He's got the lacrosse IQ, and he knows he has a free play here with a penalty that was called. The Orange does a remarkable job in terms of keeping possession. And there's Luke Roa. He's the most two-handed midfielder in the country. Another stop by Erlin. These goalies, specifically Erlin in the third quarter, he has made some nasty stops.
11 saves for Chase Erlin. A couple of years ago, this guy was playing on Memorial Day in the cage for Cornell. And if you go back to that 2022 season, it was actually a game against Syracuse at the Carrier Dome. He struggled early.
Yep.
Connor Busick pulled him, was pulled again the following week. He was a big question mark. Turned it on in the second half of a game against Princeton late that year. It was a high-scoring game. And then he was sensational in the first three rounds of the NCAA tournament, better than 60%.
So battle-tested. I had to get used to him in these shorts, though. You remember those big, baggy sweatpants. Sweats? Like the triple XL sweats?
They were in the South now. Hopkins. Looks like they're in a zone.
See the hesitation by Owen Hiltz there. You got the defense to commit, overextended, and then the step towards the middle. Hiltz is a zone buster. Rowe is a zone buster. Finn Thompson is a zone buster.
That was a man-up opportunity, I believe.
Man down, zone defense, same principles. Find an overload, spin the rock, find your wing shooters. This is big for Finn Thompson. He was a 42% shooter as a freshman. He struggled through about three, four games this season. Finding his groove is critical for the long-term success of this offense. What you love about that shot too, Anish, is that he's so relaxed when he's on that right wing. And he dips his stick low, and in one motion, he stings it high on Erlin. You almost think he's a passer from that wing just by his body language. The ball's spinning around, and then all of a sudden, bam.
What's the big adjustment that Pat March, Syracuse's offensive coordinator, made in the second half?
I think it's the passing. I think he realized in the first half, the slide rotations for the defense of Johns Hopkins, so aggressive, so quick. So I think what he's doing here, Michael Leo has the ball. He's going to give all the Hopkins defenders the reason to believe that he's going to the rack as a goal scorer. But he knows they're going to slide so early. So the midfield, specifically from up top, they've had a lot of success dodging from up top and feeding inside. They haven't had a ton of success dodging from behind and feeding the crease.
40 seconds on the game clock, about a 12-second differential between game and shot clock, and Leo will hold.
Want to tack around 10 to 15 seconds here.
Here he comes against Raposo. Help coming from Smith, who picks him up on the switch. Back to X, Spallina against Zulik. Four to shoot, three to shoot, two to shoot. Leo behind the back, does it count? It does! Michael Leo, SportsCenter, top 10.
Michael Leo has guts. If you watch the Syracuse-Maryland game, he wanted the rock at the end of a game. Dove through the crease. It was a goal mouth violation. It went to replay. There's no replay in Charlotte. This backhand shot is counting. And he puts a lot into that one. Watch how he leverages his body, catapults almost towards the cage, and in the same motion goes behind the back, putting everything into this shot. Spallina understands the shot clock in terms of where it sits. Michael Leo knows how to make it count.
And both coaches agreed that they would not have instant replay for this game.
Talk about the lacrosse IQ of a Joey Spallina. Understanding time and shot clock.
Here comes Dunn. Final seconds. Wing shot save. Will Mark. Catapults it downfield. And Smith that time getting into it with Spallina again.
Those I don't think two they like each other.
Have been jawing all game. Spallina got flagged in the first half. We go to the fourth quarter. Hopkins, the number two team of the country, down by three to Syracuse.
Live sports. ESPN Plus Originals. Exclusive home of the complete 30 for 30 library.
The moment I loved our Subaru Outback most was the moment they walked away from it.
Mom! Oh, thank goodness.
And that's why our family will only drive a Subaru.
Subaru. More IIHS Top Safety Pick Plus awards than any other brand. Love. It's what makes Subaru, Subaru.
My daughter says she works in B2B where she sells SEO and MRM to CPGs. I don't know how this happened. She was speaking in complete sentences before she was two, and now she just mumbles all these alphabets. When I call her, she says she can't speak because she needs to check the CTR on an ESM ASAP. I blame myself. Should have been around more.
Parents don't get B2B. LinkedIn does. And helping marketers reach over 70 million decision makers makes LinkedIn the place to be to be.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Players' Championship.
One way or another, I'm gonna find you. I'm gonna get you.
It's the second meeting all time between these two storied rivals who, for the better part of 3.5 decades, held dominion over the lacrosse world. Well, hasn't been the same over the last decade. They have been passed. The preseason narrative was that they are back. Hopkins, I think you can say with certainty, with the start they've had, they look like a championship team. Syracuse is really looking for that marquee win on its resume. They take a 3-goal lead into the fourth quarter here in Charlotte.
Yeah, during that span of timing, right, where both programs weren't at their best. There was the emergence of some other programs, right? First-time national champs in Denver in 2015. Notre Dame wins their first one. The game of lacrosse has changed dramatically. The amount of players from coast to coast that are on college rosters, the parity and the level between teams. We were talking about the top 10 earlier. There's 8 teams that could win a national title this year. Back in the day, there was, what, 2 to 3 maybe, legitimate?
Yeah, there was that run about 20 years ago where every championship weekend had 3 of the 4 in the group of Syracuse, Hopkins, Virginia, and Princeton.
Yes.
I mean, you could book it before the season started. Maybe you got an outlier.
Yeah, that's
but
not the case.
Three of those four were going to be there at the end. And things have changed.
And the sport is better when Hopkins and Syracuse are in the national picture. But the sport's also a lot better now that we have so many other programs that have come to the party.
Syracuse has dominated the battle at the faceoff X. Michael Leo had a highlight-worthy behind-the-back goal with the shot clock expiring. late in the third. Here comes English down the alley. And he beats Erlen over the shoulder. And Syracuse has its largest lead of the game, 12-8.
This is a terrific shot by Sammy English. I think he's going to one of the pipes on this, but he actually goes directly over Erlen's head. You see a dip of his own head, right? He dips his head a little bit. And then the ability to get this back. Continuing upfield as much as he can. That is next level body control too, because the hardest thing when you're cutting down that angle, Anish, is to not allow yourself to go east-west, to stay north-south as much as you can to keep that angle, and that's what Sammy English did.
Another face-off to Cone. You think about what guys like Brian Tevlin and Chris Fake meant to Notre Dame last year, championship pedigree from Yale. Guys like Jake Stevens, who's got the ball now, and Sam English. These guys played for some pretty good teams at Princeton. 2 years ago, English was a 30-goal scorer, the highest-scoring midfielder on a Princeton team that got to championship weekend.
And you're also not mentioning what they do in between the lines. Both Stevens and English at Princeton at one point in time were short stick defensive midfielders. Then you throw the stats that you just mentioned on top of that, they are complete midfielders.
That allows Gary Gate the flexibility to play them two ways. Here comes Roa all the way, big save. Erlen, rebound picked up by Roa.
Good awareness of Roa to understand that's a reset of the shot clock. If you're Syracuse, you want to get into the flow. Use some time here and make sure that you're going after this defense that from a pacing standpoint doesn't look like they did in the first half, Anish. They were running around like their hair was on fire in that first half.
Yeah, big difference in the first half. About half of Syracuse's shots were on goal in the third quarter. 91% of their shots on goal. Stevens against Aviles, couple of transfers. Aviles played for Syracuse the last few years. Mule spins it back, flag down. Stevens inside, body save Erlen. Hiltz on the rebound, another save. And now we get the penalty. Chase Erlen,
yeah.
Mark those down, yes. Two gargantuan saves.
He's been incredible. Some big time stops. How about the follow up by Hiltz too?
Black number 10 hole, 30-second foul.
The 30-second extra man for Syracuse. Stevens goes to the rack. That's a hold, stopping his forward progress. That's Aviles, who played at Syracuse a year ago. That's one unbelievable save. The follow-up by Hiltz, and the second one hits the pipe. You want action? We'll give you action.
Neither team has scored with the man advantage today. Both teams 0 for 3. Spolina from up top. Hiltz, 14 man-up assists last year.
Man down units packing it in. Who's the outside shooter for Syracuse?
It's gonna be hard to get it inside. Could be that guy. And this will be inbounds.
Hill saved it.
I think they'll say it went out of bounds. They signal for a quick restart.
Syracuse goes extra man again. Hopkins is daring them to beat them from the outside. They have belief and faith in Chase Erlen to gobble anything up from the outside. But they're packed in. If you're a Syracuse offensive player, who's the stretch shooter that can solve it?
Peschko against Rice. Jaronski, nice dodge. Bounce shot, score! Fifth career goal for Hunter Jaronski. Talk about versatile. He's played with the long pole and the short stick in his Hopkins career.
He's a tough guy. You think about this rope unit. Hiltz saves it. Oh, it looked like it was out of bounds.
It was out.
Definitely out of bounds. But Jaronski stays on the field. And Anish, you mentioned his journey playing so many different positions. I think of this Hopkins team and your initial attention goes to the Angeluses and the Degnans, but how this team is built is the middle of the field presence with guys like Juronski and Martin and McDermott. That's the core of this unit in terms of their full field ability to hit.
Big faceoff won by Callahan. That last Hopkins goal put an end to a 4-0 Syracuse run.
Collison looks like something's coming from his uniform or his stick.
Maybe some tape. Degnan, left hand, free, bounce shot, score. His fourth of the game.
Until Syracuse understands that Garrett Degnan is not just another player in a Hopkins uniform when he is adjacent, he's going to continue to do this. Angeles with the head up. He sees the soft spot in the Syracuse defense, and credit John Crawley for putting Degnan in different spots, right? He's a lefty sniper. He puts him up top in the middle of this offense, and Degnan continues to let it fly.
We said it earlier, he ties Reardon and Brown for most consecutive games with a goal at Johns Hopkins. Here comes Stevens, right off the faceoff win. The answer for the Orange.
They didn't have Jake Stevens available against Army. They suffered on the wing. Tonight they have him, they flourish. This is what a midfielder looks like. Someone who could scrap on defense, who could score in tight, who could gobble up a ground ball and make it count.
Now, this game came out of a slumber in the second half, didn't it? 4-3 at halftime. Great ground ball play. Kilrain, the freshman, inside to Bauer, the long pole, leading the break. We're trading haymakers
yes.
Now.
You got a veteran in Stevens. You got a young buck in Kilrain, who has incredible upside and versatility. You can play him low as a lockdown close defender. Put him on a wing and let him deal. What a pass by Kilrain. Vacuums it up, his head's up. So alert to understand that the eyes of the Syracuse defense are on him. Dylan Bauer camps out and makes it count.
What do we have? Four goals now in less than a minute between these two teams. Callahan and Mullen tied up. We're going to get a flag.
Procedure.
Withholding.
Yep.
It's going to be on Johns Hopkins. They'll get Callahan. Now, faceoffs have been the one problem area for Hopkins today.
Saying he's holding that right there on the violation. He's going to do 30. Syracuse is dominant, 20 of 28, and it's a two-headed monster with Cohen and Mullen. And then Callahan's out there, you find different cadences, and then your timing's off.
A man-up chance now for Syracuse, 0 for 4 with the EMO.
Keep in mind, too, you're going to have a trigger-shy Hopkins faceoff guy with three violations. Be 30 seconds every time he jumps moving forward.
Yeah, third faceoff violation of the half. Stevens to Spallina. Kick saved by Erland. Spallina last year had 10 man-up goals among the national leaders.
Along with Burt Whistle.
Here's Stevens. He's been on one. Jake Stevens, another tally.
He's taken over this game. He'll play a wing on a face-off. He'll take a shorty to a rack. He'll step down and make it rain. They're putting relentless pressure on Chase Erlen, making him stand on his head. Owen Hiltz, Jake Stevens, both played for John Posner at the Culver Academy back in the day. That man can coach. He understands how to teach offensive philosophy and principles. The heads up, and when they're on extra man, the ball flies.
And with the game now starting to pick up in terms of scoring, Hopkins is going to have to find a way, even if they can't win a faceoff, to neutralize Syracuse and get the ball back. In the first half, cause turnovers, those well-timed slides. That was kryptonite for losing possession battles at times. In the second half, Syracuse offensively has made the adjustment.
And you can't underestimate where we are in this game with the violations too. So you're getting crushed on the faceoffs and you violated three times. So every violation now moving forward is 30 seconds. That changes the mindset for Callahan and anyone else who's taken a draw.
Less than 9 minutes to go.
Hopkins' defense in half one was suffocating. Pat March, the offensive coordinator, and Gary Gate, the head coach, found a way to counter the high pressure, the quick slides. It's been with ball movement and crisp passing.
Spallina feeding inside, backhanded shovel by Thompson. Six to shoot. English triggers against Aviles. Feed in front, Leo. Can he beat the shot clock again? Saved by Erlen, but it gives Syracuse a fresh 60.
What a stop by Erlen.
He's been dynamite.
He has. The only thing I could say about Erlen is he's not making a ton of saves and gathering the ball. You're finding some rebounds. These high deflections, right? And it's really, it's a tough ask when you're seeing that kind of heat. But if you watch some of the goalies nationally, like Logan McNaney from Maryland, is the best at actually making the stop and securing the ball.
And this Hopkins defensive unit, they've been out there a lot. They've had to defend quite a bit in this second half. Do they get the takeaway? They do. Aviles looking for the punt return clear. He goes down hard. They'll let him play.
Christian Mulet with a monster hit.
Raposo feeding the wing. Looking for Degnan and gets away. So defensively, you're digging in for a long possession. It looks like you might have something unsettled. And now you give it right back to Syracuse. This defense has to be a little gassed right now.
And you had your guy, too. Aviles, the Syracuse transfer. Mulet, the Lehigh transfer. One Christian Mulet, zero Brandon Aviles.
Call that a Mulet kick. Stevens, a hat trick, all in this second half. Working on Martin, Hopkins' top middie on the defensive side. Here's Hiltz. We come up on 6.5 to go. For Syracuse, it's their first game this season away from home. Hopkins playing the third of three straight ACC opponents. They banked wins against UNC and Virginia. Erlen with the save, clamps down. And now, can Hopkins try to get something going? A team that cleared so well against one of the best riding teams in Virginia has struggled in the clearing game today. Just 10 out of 16.
It's been the Achilles heel. It was their strength coming in today. But Pete Milliman knows There's only limited options and opportunities moving forward.
Live sports.
Welcome to Total Wine. What can I help with?
My sister's hosting a party and she's big on tequila. What's like a really good one?
I just had this Reposado last week. Amazing.
I love it already.
And that is the lowest price anywhere.
Whoa, that's a low price.
Better make it two then.
Find what you love. Love what you find. Only at Total Wine & More.
The moment I loved our Subaru Outback most was the moment they walked away from it.
Mom! Oh, thank goodness.
And that's why our family will only drive a Subaru.
Subaru. More IIHS Top Safety Pick Plus Awards than any other brand. Love. It's what makes Subaru, Subaru.
The wipers are trash. We need to go to AutoZone. It's the only place to get Rain-X Quantum Wiper Blades. Ordered and ready for pickup.
Done.
The most passion, the most intensity. This is the way basketball's supposed to be.
Anish Rao, Paul Carcaterra here in Charlotte, North Carolina. It's been a second half surge offensively by Syracuse. They've won the possession battle. The difference is they're turning those opportunities into goals.
And for Hopkins, they've been so clean in the middle of the field. You see, there's their tempers flaring. Everyone knows how big this game is. Spallina on the doorstep. Leo behind the back. We've seen it all in this game. But for Hopkins, a team that played so well and clean a week ago, down against a Virginia team in Charlottesville who presses, they have the athletes in the middle of the field to be clean. Tonight, they're 10 of 16 clearing the ball. Coming into today, 92%. They've blown opportunities.
And Peter Milliman did tell us when we talked to him during the week, he said, as great as this program has been historically, it has been a minute since Hopkins has not been an underdog in big games. And this is certainly a big game. And now, as weird as it sounds, you're handling expectations. You're handling the target. You beat Virginia. Well, the noise, albeit positive,
it's
amplifies
new.
All
it's
of
new.
A sudden.
Yes.
Hey, Hopkins is back. Hopkins is a championship contender to go on the road and beat a Virginia team that's been one of the top two or three programs in the country for the last 4 or 5 years.
And you did it down there. And tonight, you're down three. But Syracuse has had so many opportunities to put this game away. Chase Erland's been the difference maker. He's got 15 saves, but he's worked for every single one of them.
Here comes Spallina. Shot clock at 15. 6-point game for Spallina. Using the pick from Thompson. Gets to the middle. Draws attention. It's taken away. Zulik had it momentarily. This is a big clear for Hopkins. Kilrain, the freshman, giddying up. Back to Jaronski. Bouncer. Mark got a piece of it. Shot clock reset. Hopkins has possession.
Those short stick defensive midfielders love the old school bouncer. And that drives goalies crazy. That is a hard shot for Will Mark to track.
Melendez coming out of the box. Dagnon's got four. Here comes Collison against the short stick. His shot is blocked. He picks it up. Angelus had a great look, just didn't take that extra step to get the angle.
Collison right now has the short stick matchup. 16 in black, had the 4 goals down in Charlottesville, and took that game over a week ago. He's got to be your guy right now. Melendez has a long pole on him. He's been quiet tonight. Bauer now has the long pole. Collison still the short stick. That's the matchup Hopkins has to go with.
And Angelus, who's been so good this season, at least 3 points in every game, he's been quiet. 2 assists. And if you go back to last year, the other teams would say Angelus is the head of the snake. And Hopkins' 5 losses last year, they lost 6 games last year. Angelus didn't play against Loyola, but in the 5 losses in which he played, one goal, six assists. 7 points in five of those games. Against everybody else, and in those big wins, he was putting up monster numbers. Syracuse has done a pretty good job denying him, but you know what's unique about this Blue Jay offense, Kark, is it's not one guy. They can move guys around. They can put them in different spots. They really get you spinning defensively. And I've talked to other coaches this past week, and they say, you know, our guys sometimes get a little off kilter, uncomfortable, where, hey, guard your guy, but now he's not an X. He's playing from up top, or he's playing from a high wing. Changes what you do defensively.
Yeah, interchangeable parts. The University of Maryland with John Tillman and Michael Phipps, the offensive coordinator, a lot of the same principles. I'll say this, after you're breaking down Angelus with wins and losses, he's the quarterback. He's the distributor. He's the extension of the offensive coordinator, John Crawley. So when he's feasting, the rest of the team is clicking. So the point production wins against point production and losses, it's drastic because he's always in those right pieces. So as much as it's interchangeable, Angelus is the brains behind this offense on the field.
He's got it now. Over to Melendez, who's without a point. Melendez had 30-plus goals last year, the Marquette transfer. Collison from the outside, and it's not the shot that you want.
And if you're Melendez, after watching him late in the season and how strong of a dodger he was, if someone said you're getting short-sticked in a game like this, you got to go to the rack.
Yeah, he gave it up. Can they find Degnan, who's taken a team-high 13 shots? 4 goals, 7 on Cage. They do, and that is number 5 for the sixth-year senior and the two-time captain, Garrett Degnan.
Anish, I'm going to say it till I'm blue in the face.
You're playing with fire.
You're playing with fire, and you can't treat him adjacent when he's the next man in the rotation like you would any other player. This is Garrett Degnan. He will feast if he has that much time and room. You have to press out and defend him differently. When he's adjacent, slough to him. Show more. Just make him think when he catches it, he's not going to have the time to step and rip. And that's not the case for everyone else. His rules are different.
Oh, what a great finish here at the Crown Lacrosse Classic in Charlotte, North Carolina. A city that continues to grow in its embrace of lacrosse. Angelus, big face-off win there for the Blue Jays to gain possession. In the shot clock era, you can't just sit on it.
Can't, and as Quint would say many, many years ago, not every face-off is created equally.
Right.
And it's so true. In these pressure moments, you have the three violations. Hopkins finds a way to dig deep and get that possession.
Degnan from that right wing. Alexo guarding Collison, who gets it back from Bauer. Now Angelus. 30 to shoot, plenty of time. Collison thought about it. Alexo trying to get into his body. Degnan looking for number 6. There's the quick double on 40. Degnan to the cage. And a flag goes up. Will Hopkins go man up?
You know what I'm impressed with Garrett Degnan is his counter move when teams are pressing out.
I'm not a shooter. I can dodge a little too.
And that's the best way you can develop another aspect of your game if you're Garrett Degnan. Teams are going to fly out to you, dip underneath. Got a slash on Syracuse. This is going to be a one-minute penalty. The other player who's done a terrific job in his last year of having that counter game is Jacob Morin from Army. A lot of teams are pressing out at number 90, who shoots a zillion miles an hour. Now he has that counter where he's getting underneath defenders when they flash.
Big extra man opportunity for the Blue Jays. Looking to close to within one. And they do! Collison, who had the 4 goals a week ago.
He's such a big target, Anish. And if he catches it, he can handle pressure too. He will soak a check. So when you find 16 in black inside, you can almost force feed him. The ball's spinning. And look who's behind, making the pass. Jacob Angelis to Matt Collison. The head is always up, the timing, he just takes another step upfield. That is beautiful execution by 23 in black. He knows if he can just continue to go upfield, he'll get the eyes of the defense and find Collison inside.
Blue Jays have only won 9 of 30 faceoffs today. Cohn wins another one. Now trying to play keep away, and Gary Gates saw Cohn was in trouble before he got rid of the ball. He uses one of his two timeouts. 2:22 to go, fourth quarter. There's always something special about this rivalry. And when they start to empty the spice rack with so much at stake for a regular season game, I'm not equating this to some of the battles they've had on championship weekend or Memorial Day, but these are two teams who feel they're on the ascent, and they hope they can maybe reprise this Memorial Day weekend. Hopkins has banked some quality wins. Syracuse doesn't really have anything shiny on its resume. It's an opportunity for Syracuse, and if you're the Blue Jays and you can come back and pull this thing out, Carr, when we look at their resume and we look at some of the wins that they've banked, if they do well in conference,
oh, yeah,
you might be talking about the number one overall seed.
Yeah, this team is really loaded, and they're so deep. You know, 11 of their top scorers back from a year ago. Defensively, they run so many short stick defensive midfielders, and their close defense has really found an identity too. They can cover, not to mention you have Chase Erland too, who's been unbelievable. He's made some critical stops when this game could have gone away from Hopkins. Just stopping Sammy English on the doorstep. Stopping Jake Stevens on the doorstep. But Syracuse has had the offense, and specifically in the second half, finding the seams in the aggressive defense of Johns Hopkins. The crisp passing, the through passes. Getting an overextending Hopkins aggressive D to bite. And they're shooting. Found the sweet spots. But Anish, you talk about the trajectory of these seasons. Every single player on Syracuse knows they can compete with anyone nationally. They're two top five losses to Army and Maryland, both in overtime. But there becomes a point in time it's not good enough. You have to win one of these. You have to learn how to win. Hopkins is learning how to win. This is a moment in time where Syracuse has to find a way to win, to give the confidence that they've learned to close out a game.
Yeah, and when I talked to Gary Gate yesterday, those were his exact words. He said, we have to learn how to finish these games. Gate and Peter Milliman now the sideline crosshairs of this rivalry. It was once Desco and Petro. Before that, Simi and Zim.
So what's interesting right now is you have plenty of time on the shot clock. You have Sam English who can go both ways. So if Syracuse loses the ball, you have one guy that could get in the hole, and Sam English. Finn Thompson, not a defensive specialist. Michael Leo, not a defensive specialist. Leo was an attackman in high school. So Sammy English, if they turn the ball over, he has the responsibility to get back on defense.
Look how far Deans presses out. He's Hopkins, top LSM. Only a one goal game when we come up on 90 seconds to play. Thompson, marked by Martin. Now Spallina wearing the Fable 22. Eyeing up Smith. He gets a pick from Thompson. Spallina fires. That's coming back. It's turned away. Saved by Erland again. And a new 60. So if you're Syracuse now, you can take this down. to about, what, 20 seconds, 16 seconds.
Anish, you could argue that that's better than a goal because it doesn't go back to the face-off X.
Well, now does Hopkins press out. Deans almost came away with the turnover. Blue Jays don't have any timeouts, neither do Syracuse. Erlin is out of the cage. Now Spallina near the midfield line. 22 on 22. Erlin looking to stay with him. Help coming from Smith. Spallina dumps it over to English. 35 seconds to go. 18 on the shot clock.
You don't shoot if you're Syracuse unless there's like 5 seconds left
now
on the
Erlin
shot clock.
Now Erlin gets back into the cage. Less than 10 to shoot. Leo trying to play keep away. Over to English, 2 to shoot. English, and that's off the stick of Mulet, and Syracuse will take that. They can set their defense with 15 seconds.
This is a learning experience for Syracuse. They got beat on a quick whistle and a clear against Maryland. You have to defend inside out.
Martin has it dislodged, able to recover. Quickly up ahead, Jaronski can't come up with it. Syracuse with the ball, 3.5 seconds to go. Alexo throws it into the air, and the Orange get their biggest win of 2024. They get a win that puts a shining star on their resume come Selection Sunday. First win against Hopkins since 2020. Syracuse is 6-2. And they just knocked off the number 2 team in the country. Just a terrific game. We haven't heard the last of Johns Hopkins,
No.
But for a young Syracuse team, they finally learned to close.
This Hopkins team is battle-tested. They're loaded. They can make a run at a national championship. But tonight, Syracuse learned how to win. And this is the biggest win for Gary Gate in his 3 years. Yes, he beat Duke in year one, but the team was struggling. This team, with the expectations of being back and actually answering with a win, beyond significant for Gate.
One more chapter to the most storied rivalry in the sport of lacrosse. Two teams that often bring out the best in each other. They did today. A fun second half, a fun finish in Charlotte. The Crown Lacrosse Classic puts on another great event. And the marquee, Hopkins and Syracuse, lives up to the top 10 billing. The Orange hold on for a 14-13 win. For Paul Carcaterra and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Anish Shroff, saying good night from the Queen City.